Hello, and welcome to Berkshire Health Program. I'm your host, Dr. Rebecca Kane. Our topic today is aphasia, and my guest is speech-language pathologist Deborah MacDonald. Thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Dr. Kane.
Let's talk a little about what it means to be a speech-language pathologist. What kind of training do you have, and what kinds of things do you treat?
Okay, so anyone who's licensed to practice as a speech-language pathologist will have gotten at least a master's degree. Sometimes folks will have a PhD. And in the practice where I am now at Berkshire Medical Center, I work in outpatient rehab. I see folks who have had strokes. I see people with voice disorders, maybe folks who stutter. I see people with swallowing difficulties, brain-injured people, and people with progressive diseases like Parkinson's disease.
And in addition to speech, it's speech and language. So why is that specified in the title?
Speech and language. So speech is just the production of speech, the pronunciation of speech. Voice is included in what we consider speech. But language is the use, for most of us, it's unconscious use of rules of language to put sentences together and to communicate our emotions and our thoughts.
So you put some of this on the first slide, which we can bring up. So it's the difference between the physical forming of the words as opposed to a method of a communication?
Right, yeah. Yes. Okay. And communication involves more than just speech. It's something that most of us, or many of us, may not think about. But communication, of course, involves facial expression and gestures. And included in communication is reading, writing, listening, and speaking.
So, and we're going to go over that in more detail later. Let's talk about aphasia. What is it exactly?
Okay, aphasia is an impairment of language, or ability to communicate, as I was saying a moment ago, one's thoughts and feelings.
So it's the communication issue rather than the pronunciation so much.
It is.
And we have a couple other pictures. One was a nice picture of the brain. Can you explain what we're looking at here?
Yes, what we're looking at is a view from the left side of the brain. Most people who have aphasia will have had some injury to some area within that purple shaded area. For some people, that entire area might be affected. For most people, portions of that area may be affected. For most of us, the left side of the brain is the language dominant portion of the brain. So damage within that purple shaded area is very likely to result in some difficulty with communication.
I remember learning, and correct me if I'm wrong, that when you learn a new language, it goes to a different part of the brain, and then when you achieve fluency, it goes to the central part of the speech. Does that of the speech localization? Does that make sense?
It does make sense.
Is it real?
I can't show you where that shaded area might be, but yes, it's still going to be very likely in the left side, left hemisphere of the brain.
So, can you contrast aphasia with other kinds of disorders that might affect a person's ability to communicate?
Sure. The important thing to remember with aphasia, for most people who have aphasia, they are just as smart as always. Their intelligence hasn't been affected. Very much of their personality remains the same. I say very much because it's a quite difficult disorder to cope with. So there can often be depression that goes along with it.
It must be very frustrating to know what you want to say and not be able to say it.
Indeed. You just described pretty perfectly what aphasia is about, having an idea, being very clear about what one wants to communicate and having difficulty communicating that. It's usually not so much about difficulty pronouncing words. There may be some struggle to pronounce with some people who have aphasia, but usually not so much about pronunciation.
So what kinds of problems would cause this, would cause aphasia? Because aphasia is not necessarily the disease itself, right? It's sort of a symptom of something else that's happened in the brain.
Right. It might be considered a condition, often related to stroke. Other times it might be related to a brain injury, a blow to the head. It might be related to a brain tumor. It might be related to infection or even medication misuse. Mm-hmm. And those, there are some types of aphasia, like the medication response, that might be reversible, but most times it's not reversible.
So when there's a stroke or head trauma, the cause of the aphasia is pretty obvious.
Yes.
And it's pretty sudden onset.
Exactly.
There are other forms that are a little more insidious, which we're going to get to later on in the program.
Right.
From a clinical perspective, from my perspective, pretty much anybody who has this kind of presentation is going to have some kind of imaging of the head. So
yes.
We start with that. Did they have a stroke? Do they have a tumor? You know, what's going on in the brain?
Right.
And sometimes we find the answer, and sometimes the MRI looks fine.
Yes,
right.
That's
so
true.
So the diagnosis is clinical.
Yes.
Right. There's no test to diagnose aphasia except for you talk to the patient and you make the diagnosis based on how they communicate.
Right. So from your perspective, the primary care or someone who's evaluating a person who's hospitalized would guess that this person is having difficulty communicating. Then when we come along, the speech-language pathologist, we look more in depth at all of those components of communication that I mentioned earlier. We see what might be especially challenging for a person. Some people have more difficulty understanding communication. Some people have more difficulty saying what they want to say. Sometimes people even have difficulty with numbers and understanding number concepts like time.
And you had put together a couple more slides. So the fourth one, which we can put up briefly, lists the possible causes of aphasia, which we talked about before. And then the fifth one is more what you were talking about just now, which is reading, writing, listening. I understand it affects listening. Is that affecting comprehension?
Yes, definitely affecting comprehension. And it does depend on the specific area of the brain that's involved, that has been probably deprived of oxygen as a result of the stroke or injury. And so, yes, it is about understanding. So a person might have a special difficulty following directions if I were to give a person more than one direction. It might make a difference if I give a direction with a gesture. If I say, why don't you take a drink? That probably makes more sense than why don't you take a drink?
Okay, that makes sense. Okay. So let's shift gears a little bit just for a moment to talk about the incidence and prevalence of this condition. The sixth slide that you put together, we can go through, because this is actually not a terribly uncommon presentation.
Yes, exactly. It's surprising when we think about it sometimes. I don't have it on the slide, but there are something like 2 million Americans who are living with aphasia now, and only about 80% of people surveyed say that they have ever heard of aphasia. So it's relatively common, more common, in fact, than even Parkinson's disease. So it's out there, but apparently not everyone has encountered someone who has this challenge.
Well, this came in the news recently because an actor was diagnosed. Do you have any thoughts as to what might be going on with that particular actor that I think most people watching will know who I'm talking about?
Yes.
Without having read his medical chart, of course.
Right, of course. I do have thoughts. The interesting component about that, all I know is that this person's family said that the person was no longer acting because he has aphasia. As we said earlier, when a person has had a stroke or a brain injury, there's a sudden onset. We can associate the aphasia with that onset. If a person has a stroke and suddenly shows signs of difficulty communicating, we can associate the aphasia with the stroke. We haven't heard from this family that there was such an injury with this person. In fact, there are some stories in what I consider reputable sources that say that this person had been having some difficulty prior to this announcement a couple of months ago. My guess is that what possibly is the case is called primary progressive aphasia. As that term says, it is progressive. it usually shows up gradually. It's not something that a person wakes up with one day, suddenly has trouble communicating. It shows up slowly over time.
So we have that seventh slide that you put together. And some of these things you described already, and worsening over time, so it's a little more subtle. So what might be some of the earliest signs of a primary progressive aphasia?
Early signs would be trouble saying what one wants to say. There's certainly normal change in one's word retrieval ability with time passing. However, if a person shows these signs over time, more and more frequently having trouble retrieving a word or maybe mixing up sentences, then there might be reason for concern.
Is primary progressive aphasia a form of dementia?
It is. Yes, it is. It's different from other dementias. However, as the slide says, over time, we do usually see changes in a person's thought process. Mm. So usually some changes in memory and orientation, that sort of thing, knowing what day it is and what's about to happen today.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk a bit about what you do with these patients. Understanding that primary progressive aphasia is going to be much more difficult to treat.
Yes.
So I want to focus our discussion more on someone who's had a stroke or a more definitive cause of the aphasia.
Sure.
Because, of course, with the brain plasticity, those, I think, are the patients who we can see the most improvement with.
Right. Right. Exactly.
So what do you do in a speech therapy session? How would you start off?
Well, I would start off with an evaluation. We see somebody for a period of time in which we ask them to participate in exercises with those bits of communication that I've already mentioned. We check to see whether the person is able to comprehend what they read, comprehend what they hear, whether they're able to write, and how well they can express themselves. And when we look at writing, we sometimes need to see a person writing with their non-dominant hand. Because of that damage to the left side of the brain, there's often difficulty using the right hand, which is dominant for most people. So we take into account that they might be writing with a non-dominant hand.
So I'm left-handed.
Oh.
So what sort of advantage do I have?
Well, I have recently worked with somebody who has aphasia, who is left-handed, and that person can write more carefully with that dominant hand, which is the left. And that's the advantage, is the writing might be more clear as far as not shaky, and more controlled. But depending upon the area of the brain that's damaged, we might see that you wouldn't be able to, if I ask you to write the word cat, you might write the letter C and then not know what else to write.
So it won't affect my mechanical ability to
write,
but the communication may still be impaired.
Right, yes.
Okay, so as you're working with a patient, you've done the initial evaluation, you've determined what the patient needs, where their deficits are. What sorts of tools do you use in your work to help somebody improve?
It's very much individualized. The brain is pretty complicated, as I think most of us know. Mm-hmm. Depends on the sort of damage and the degree of impairment. Some people have pretty minimal impairment, and some people are much more impaired. So it depends on that. And we would focus, of course, on the strengths. So if a person has particular strength with reading, I would utilize that to help them to improve their ability to speak and communicate through speech. Excuse me. I will, whenever possible, involve the person's primary communication partner. Many times that's a spouse, sometimes it's a friend or a family member. My time consists of coaching those two in communicating with one another, providing pointers specific to their communication challenges.
I imagine it's an advantage if you have you've been married for 40 years and you're in one of these relationships where you already finish each other's sentences.
Yes.
You know, the partner can sometimes have a sense of what the person is trying to say, even though they can't say it.
Exactly. It's not uncommon for me to be in a room with a person that I'm treating and a partner and watch their communication. I might not have a good idea about what's transpiring, but because of their knowing of one another for such a long period of time, they do have ideas about what the person might want to be saying.
Would there be any concern that a partner that's too involved might slow the improvement of a patient with aphasia?
Perhaps. I guess I don't think of slowing improvement. There is usually suggestion coming from me and involving the person with aphasia, asking, for example, do you want your partner to finish your sentence for you if you're having trouble finding a word? Or do you want to be given time to try to retrieve that word?
And then how would a patient with aphasia communicate their response to that question?
I would ask probably a yes-no question rather than an open-ended question. Mm-hmm. So yes-no would be something like, do you want your partner to finish your sentence when you have trouble with words? Open-ended would be, do you want your partner to finish your sentence, or do you want to try to think of the word by yourself?
Right. So it's a more complicated way to ask the question.
Yes.
And if the patient has trouble expressing themselves verbally, gestures may be easier to use. I've certainly had patients with aphasia who can nod their head or shake their head, even though it's harder for them to verbalize their words.
Yes. I encourage any type of communication that is available to a person. If a person is particularly spatially oriented, so I've worked with people who have worked in construction, for example, who are used to building things, they often can draw a simple picture of what they're thinking. Not something detailed, but if it's hard for them to say what they're talking about, they might draw a version of a car to say that they're wanting to go somewhere.
Communication comes in all different flavors.
Yes.
So just trying to work with the patient with their strengths, like you mentioned earlier, to really just help them be able to communicate. It may not be restoration of speech as much as a redevelopment of some way to get their thoughts and feelings and needs across.
Yes.
Why don't you show us some of the tools that you brought?
Okay. So the tools that I have are applied more often to people who are more severely impaired. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we often see is that people don't respond reliably to those yes, no questions that I mentioned. A person may always answer by saying yes or just nodding. And so then we know that we can't rely on that. So I might show them these two pages that, and I'm using the red and the green quite deliberately to try to enhance the meaning of these things.
Like a traffic light?
Yes, yes. So I have the type nice and big, so I imagine it's easier to see. So I might then ask my yes-no question, do you want your partner to finish the sentence for you, and ask a person to point to the answer. For some people, responding to yes and no questions is the one reliable thing that we can use. Mm. Sometimes we can't get much farther along than that. In many cases, with a person with aphasia, we refer to something called the communication burden. And the communication burden falls on the partner, whether that's a spouse or the treating person. So for me, I have to know to ask you to respond to yes, no, and sometimes there's a lot of guessing about what a person might want to communicate. Another tool that I sometimes use is called supported conversation. This is usually with someone who is rather severely impaired as well, usually someone who has difficulty putting things into words. If I were working with you, I might use something like this. This is quite dynamic. I wrote this up in advance. I would be writing this as we speak. And I might say to you, do you have plans for the weekend? And because I have that visual, it might enhance what we're saying. Also, if I'm working with you on a Friday, that helps to contextualize and make sense that we're talking about the weekend.
Helps to orient.
If the person, if you're my person and you don't respond, I might guess, are you going on a picnic? Or maybe your spouse told me that you have that plan. Mm-hmm. That might elicit some attempts to speak. And then if I know that you like food, I might say, what kind of food are you going to eat? And a person then might be able to say a couple of things about what they expect to have or hope to have on their picnic. An interesting thing about supported conversation, I use plain paper and always a black Sharpie, so mm-hmm. I have a pretty thick line. When I finish this page, I go on to the next page, and all of these pages remain available on the table in front of us. It allows a person to refer to something earlier on in our conversation. Right. They might page through and go back to the picnic if we've gone on to something else.
Yes, tell us about this app. I'm fascinated.
Okay. This is an app called Speech Assistant. This doesn't work for everyone. Again, this is usually something we might think about after we've gotten to know a person pretty well and decide that this may be useful. We do provide some coaching as well. It's been pretty rare in my experience that I hand this app to a person and they say, oh, I can do this. It, of course, involves reading. It involves reading and selection.
You require a certain base level of communication ability to even use something like
this. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, it's a more complex tool.
Some people are completely uncomfortable with technology, mm-hmm. and this could just be intimidating to them. So I have already in the field here something that I selected from a button, and so the device will speak when I press this button.
Hello, how are you?
This voice isn't great. This speech assistant app is affordable for most people. Mm-hmm. That's why we have it available here. And I believe this is a slightly older version. There are much, much better voices available mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. than we're hearing now. So I'll show how I select as we go. I'm going to touch this button.
Could you help me?
The button said, could you help me? And of course, the device repeated that for us. And there are various pages here with different categories of information that a person may want to communicate about. Feelings, medical things, family is a big one. Most mm-hmm. people enjoy communicating about their families.
Mm-hmm. And we had talked earlier about the emotional burden of aphasia, how frustrating it is and how it can lead to depression. There's a support group available at Berkshire Health System for people who suffer from aphasia and for their family members. So how can people at home find out about this?
Yes, thanks.
This is our last slide, number 8.
Yes, okay. So we are in the outpatient rehab department at Berkshire Medical Center, and there's a phone number included on the slide. So if folks have questions related to what they've heard here today, they're certainly welcome to call and ask for more information. Our aphasia support group meets once a month. I'm the person who facilitates that. It's been a little bit different during pandemic. There was a period of time when we didn't meet at all, and people, of course, are reluctant to come to public places mm-hmm. still. But we do have that. It's an opportunity for folks to meet other folks who have similar challenges and for care partners to meet other care partners and to see other folks who have similar challenges.
It can be an important source of support.
Yes.
And I imagine this kind of thing is very hard to do remotely. Other support groups have been meeting through Zoom, but something like this where gestures become an important part of the conversation and communication, really hard to do virtually.
Exactly. There is more challenge than with someone who's not impaired. There's also that technology piece, which can be challenging for any of us. Mm-hmm. And so that's a part of the challenge. So we haven't done remote meetings. It's been in person.
It's been all in person.
Yes.
And do the same people come back again and again then?
Yes, they do. They do.
So you can sort of form a community.
Exactly. That's what it turns out to be, mm-hmm. a fine community of folks who cheer one another on.
So this has been great, and I really appreciate you coming on the show. We're actually out of time. I know
okay.
it goes quick.
Thanks so much.
So I'm with Deborah MacDonald, who's a speech-language pathologist at Berkshire Health Systems. Our topic today was aphasia. I'm your host, Dr. Rebecca Kane. Thanks for joining me, and I'll see you next time.